Well, I will start my presentation talking about a topic that here and there was in emergence today, that is a symbolic acquisition, a symbolic ability, that is a way that our species becomes able to become able to using sign to communicate, and much more. I have some slides that will accompany my lecture. This slide have a text in English, so sorry, but I couldn't correct and put the text in your language, but I hope that explaining it will be okay. Symbolic ability is far more than a mere tool for communicating. It is a powerful technology, probably the main reason behind the evolution of the human species. The horizons that humans are staring at, as well as the cage they are living in. This acquisition is at the basis of the peculiar human attitude to invent technologies and create devices, tools, machines, even new life forms. When the symbolic ability acquisition was born, this is mostly considered an inappropriate question by anthropologists, because before the use of images, it is only possible to refer to anatomic comparisons. What can be said is that since humans share the symbolic ability, also in a minor part, with primates like the chimpanzee, most probably our common progenitor had this ability in a primitive form. This means estimating its early roots very approximately to 6-7 million years ago. Symbolic acquisition gave birth to the communication forms and tools that are peculiar of our species. Orality, images, writing, in all the evolutions until the contemporary mediascape. Models and projects can be easily exchanged, shared, and adopted with symbols. With a symbolic ability, our ancestors achieved three main correlated goals: knowledge, protection, and effectiveness. Knowledge of the environment by transducing it into symbolic models that could be shared, discussed, and improved. Protection from the environment, thanks to the tools, artifacts, and behaviors derived from the symbolic models. Effectiveness on the environment, thanks to the projects, tools, and artifacts built from the symbolic models that could modify the environment and contrast or distract its pressure. By means of symbols and with the tools that were produced, our ancestors began to know, control, and manage the environment, and at the same time, they established a sort of safety distance from the physical world, creating an increasingly wide and complex anthropic sphere. Maybe the most obvious example of this safety distance is the average life expectation that came from 30 years among the ancient Greeks and Romans to 40 years as the end of life in the 19th century until today, where in some part of the world, in some very lucky part of the world, it has almost doubled. Symbolic ability opened up a world of opportunities. Through symbols, information, experiences, and values can be easily collected, transmitted, and exchanged, forming a shared knowledge separated from the substance of the phenomenal reality. In the laboratory of symbols, it is possible to test hypotheses and simulate their impact on the world, originating a design ability that gave birth to increasingly advanced artifacts. Symbols can mediate in the conflict among people, reducing them to some kind of linguistic intercourse, or conversely, they can inflame conflicts, raising walls and distances. Abstraction, projects, remote communication in space and time, consciousness, imagination, are based on symbols. The realm of possible and the idea of future with project and expectations are born from symbols and can only be described through symbols. Through symbols, humans have boosted the speed of cultural evolution, allowing our ancestors to reduce the adaptation time to the environment, limiting or shifting its pressure. Instead of many generations and hundreds or thousands of years of evolution through natural selection, achievement can require just one generation by adopting and sharing ideas, inventions, projects, discoveries, behaviors, in a process where a key role was probably played by mirror neurons. Symbolic ability generated a huge acceleration in human culture, which is evident in particular in the communication realm. A particular subsystem of symbolic language is digital language, a simple yet powerful meta-instrument. In a few decades since the introduction of computers, digital language has colonized the mediascape. Some features of cinema are seemingly holding up to this process, but it is only a matter of time. With digital-based technologies, it is possible to simulate phenomena and use them in many fields, from entertainment to science. Static and dynamic subjects, objects, and environments which copy reality and that could have never been displayed before with traditional techniques can be created in movies, video games, scientific visualization, and virtual reality applications, opening up unprecedented narrative scenarios. The new expressive opportunities enhance the cognitive aspects of simulation, expanding the cultural dimension. Digital language is powerful in many tasks: describing, simulating, understanding, quantifying, controlling, managing, foreseeing, storing, retrieving, and sharing phenomena. It does it through a rigid opposition, 1-0, yes, no, with no intermediate states, making discrete the phenomena it represents. One of the most mentioned differences between analog and digital is that the former is continuous and the latter is discrete. But is really true? In a comparison between an analog and digital photograph, in a larger both pictures, neither image, albeit at different magnification scales, show continuity or regularity, but rather discontinuities. Both images show patterns of discrete, non-continuous configurations. The difference is that in an analog photograph, the form and the size of silver salt grains that codify and compose the image vary all along the photosensitive surface, while in the digital photograph, the shape and the size of the pixel that codify and compose the image are the same all along the picture surface. Therefore, the distinction between discrete and continuous cannot be considered as absolute in differentiating between analog and digital, because it is a function of the magnification process. It depends on the scale and the resolution at which the phenomena is considered. What emerges from the comparison between analog and digital photograph can be extended to a more general purpose. Both analog and digital are discontinuous, discrete. The difference is that digital is discrete, regular, and analog is discrete, chaotic, or unordered. The digital is widely used to build simulation of reality, and sometimes even as a metaphor of the world. Of course, it is essential to remember that the models made through the digital are just models, representations, that is, reduction of reality according to traits considered relevant, distinctive, and significant by a culture. One of the main applications of the digital is the Internet of Things. The Internet of Things, I will try to go through this slide and explain this slide, is the result of a process that can be resumed in four phases. In the first phase, to your left, in the first phase, only some sparse desktop computer and PC are connected. This is the phase of connecting and exchanging information. In the second phase, the mobile computers are added. Laptops, notebooks, laptops enlarge the typology of connected devices, and wireless networks are added, allowing to exchange information in mobility. This is the phase of connecting and exchanging information in mobility. In the third phase, that is the present one, networks are expanded to include mobile connections, and many devices are added, phones and smartphones, music players, e-readers, GPS devices, tablets, and some appliances like television sets, DVD, multimedia devices, fridges, while domotics is on the way. This process is accelerating, involving increasingly connected devices. The net is becoming the cloud, with data and calculation operated over a dispersed architecture. This is the phase of connecting and exchanging information everywhere. In the fourth phase, that is to the right, the Internet of Things phase, all objects can exchange data, taking an active role and creating a pervasive and interconnected system. Through Internet of Things, the virtual world maps the physical world, providing an identity to things, places, and to the whole artificial realm that we could call a second nature, that material dimension increasingly pervasive and extended, created by humankind. Everything will be interconnected. This is a phase of connecting and exchanging information everywhere and of controlling the artificial environment. This process, of course, will not stop. Internet of Things could become the most pervasive and effective control system of the territory ever evolved, in the human case ever invented, by a species. Since the further step will be the interconnection of the natural environment. For all species, therefore for humans too, territory inspecting and controlling are primary activities. Internet of Things will interconnect the artificial and natural environment, pervading them with data flows and making them intimately interrelated. There are already applications for monitoring earthquakes, weather, fires, vulcans, climate change, forest animals migrations, and endangered species. The control of the environment will be increasingly pervasive and sophisticated through the collaboration of digital, optical, bio, robo, and nanotechnologies. Internet of Things will put in opposition the legitimacy of environment inspection with privacy safeguard. The next part of my presentation is about life, but since this morning we had a very interesting discussion about this topic, I think that I can jump some parts. What I want to say is that some related question. The first one is that as we know, organic as opposed to inorganic is realm of the living. And I want to enhance this. That is of living beings, plants, and animals. And over the centuries, many disciplines have attempted to define the boundaries of the living, that is, of what is alive on Earth. So I will go through very, very quickly to this slide. Since there are no known life forms outside Earth, we have not yet discovered them, the organic and carbon-based idea of life has been extrapolated as a universal one. But life seems escaping. Here you can see many definitions from many disciplines in the field of biology, evolutionary biology, neo-Darwinism, physics, biochemistry, geophysiology, and biology of cognition. And there could be more definitions, but none of them is exhaustive. Life escapes. At the human scale, we are reasonably sure that we can distinguish what is alive and what is not. But as a microscopic scale, for instance, the boundaries blur. What makes a conglomeration of chemicals or a mass of matter a living organism? is e-fly possibly a function of the scale at which it is observed? Life appears as a sort of continuum without fences between organic and inorganic. This contiguity between what is alive and what is not should not be surprising. According to abiogenesis and biopoiesis, life arose from non-living matter about 4 billion years ago. Organic and inorganic are contiguous osmotic universes, and today both can be combined in disciplines such as nanotechnology, robotics, and synthetic biology. Art has also crossed this barrier, since the realm of genetic art, which involves DNA in the very broadest sense, includes both organic-based art forms and non-organic ones, such as computer simulations of life, of genetic processes, of evolution and growth. Recapitulating the evolution, art builds a bridge between the organic and the inorganic. Organic and inorganic are two different paths of the living that also through art can expand humankind's knowledge and creations by interacting and interbreeding. But life can emerge also from the inorganic realm. Artificial reality has developed the idea of studying life in its organization in single beings, in its social dimension, and in its evolution, simulating some feature of life itself by means of computer programs. Like robotics, artificial life operates with a bottom-up approach. Starting from single connected elements, it enables the setting up of increasingly complex systems. Unlike robotics, which builds entities with a physical body that must act in the physical world, artificial life generates life forms that live inside computers and may eventually act in the physical world by means of effectors. Artificial life frees life from the material dimension, expanding the idea and the limits of life outside the organic realm and making it more general, universal. The living is no longer defined by the matter it is made of, but by the instructions that rule it. The living is the best model when making tools, machines, devices, organisms, which beyond being useful for humans, have to survive to damages, errors, defects, and viruses. They have also to be able to self-repairing to a certain extent, to autonomously work in and adapt to the environment, to interact with unexpected situations and itches, like the living normally does. The living is the best model because it has demonstrated its efficiency in the last 4 billion years of evolution. It already has experience of the world. On one side, science and technology can operate on the human body in a process that has been developing with evolving techniques since the dawn of human history. Today, muscles, skin, bones, organs, brain, genes could be cured, enhanced, modified, and substituted, generating a sort of expanded humanity. Many ideas that for centuries had been pivotal for society's existence are put in discussion, redefining the meaning and the limit of human nature, human condition, and human culture. This process can be noticed in the attention that today is paid to environment issues and to animals' rights, for instance, and it is evident in movements like transhumanism and posthumanism. On the other side, scientific and technological evolution seems leading to new living creatures. Modified and expanded organisms, autonomous agents, artificial life forms, robotic and biorobotic constructs, nanoentities, organic and inorganic hybrids, synthetic matter and life, clones, extinct organisms revived through de-extinction by means of genetic engineering and selective breeding. We are going to assist in an extension of the idea of life to a complex panorama with organic, inorganic, and intermingled life forms. These entities and organisms originated from human culture could evolve, constituting a third life, being first life, the natural organic life, and second life, the life in the symbolic realm, that has not to be confused with the famous 3D virtual world. All these processes could lead to an evolutionary step. The rise of the symbolic intelligence in our ancestors generated the outburst of tools and artifacts and deeply changed the interaction with the environment, creating the anthropic world we know. In an early phase, since the Paleolithic, the new forms depend on humans and are mainly human extension, also increasingly complex. They expand the body, the senses, and the mind. But step by step, these forms are becoming autonomous. And due to the pressure of the anthropic environment, they could evolve as living entities, organic, hybrid, and inorganic. These forms are not the result of natural selection. They are selected by human culture and habitat instead. The more the anthropic environment expands and develops, the more these forms proliferate, diversifying and evolving. This is not new. Since the ancient times, humankind has been trying to simulate or emulate the living in order to participate to the myth of creation. Beyond the arts that for millennia have been representing natural life, worth remembering the Greek telos, the Jewish golem, the medieval, Renaissance and 18th century automata, the 19th century Frankenstein, the 20th century robots and androids, cyborgs and replicants in cinema, literature and art, the contemporary social and industrial robots, the space machines that are also on Mars. Automata and robots, the children of our minds, according to Hans Moravec, are historically present in many cultures, from Europe to Russia, to Islam, to China, to Japan. And since prehistory, humans have also been modifying and creating life, giving birth to new varieties of animals and plants by crossbreeding the existing ones. Now there is a very interesting exhibition about Islam robots in Germany at the Center for Arts and Culture in Karlsruhe, curated by Peter Weibel and Sigrid Zilinski. Nature and evolution seem going beyond the mere biological roots, expanding and overstepping the biological realm in an evolution that originates from human species. Human culture is a pollinator of this new natural genesis. On one hand, our species increases its awareness and consciousness. On the other hand, it is the initiator of a speciation process that brings to life new entities starting from what is called the artificial, that is the natural peculiar of human species. Why does all this originate from human species? To what extent will human be able to lead and manage this process? Will this configure an evolutionary leap, the diaspora of a species that cancels itself in its cultural heritage? These are questions that worth answering. In the last part of my intervention, I will try to present a sort of, let's call so, double relativization process. Today, humanity is endangered in a profound rethinking about the relationship with the environment, with the resources consumption, and all related responsibilities. From a general point of view, this is embedded in a wider relativization process taking place at two levels, on and outside Earth. This process is evident in the sequence of models that have historically been used to describe the world around us. According to Western narration, the geocentric system was proposed by Greek astronomer Exodus of Cnidos, in touch with the idea proposed by his mentor Plato, And later it was perfected by Aristotle and especially Hipparchus and Ptolemy in the 2nd century AD, quickly replacing the archaic cosmology. In Ptolemaic model that remains in vogue about 2,000 years, Earth is the center of the universe. This model is put in crisis by Copernican model that instead puts the Sun in the center of the universe. Enunciated at the beginning of the 16th century, it was endorsed by observation data collected by Tycho Brahe, who remained a Ptolemaic supporter, and especially by Galileo's telescope. Further relativization occurs at the birth of cosmology in the first decade of the 20th century, when the solar system is inserted into a galaxy, the Milky Way, not really in the center, and the existence of other galaxies is proven. Thanks to astronomers like Slipher, Friedman, and Hubble, the idea of an expanding universe was introduced, and in 1927, Lemaître proposed the Big Bang theory. Recent studies have shaped a vast universe evolving in space and time that can be coughed almost until its origin. To this relativization process outside Earth that moved Earth from the center of the universe to a periphery of a dispersed vast panorama corresponds a similar process inside Earth. In the beginning, humankind was put on top of living beings. In the chain of being, illustrated as a stairway from lower to higher order of beings, humans are just before the sky, the angels and God. In the Genesis, man, who is the chosen creator on earth, the first and highest among the living beings, gets from God the dominion over all creatures. 3 centuries after Copernicus, Darwin provides a new contribution to the relativization process by depriving the human species of its position at the top of the pyramid. All living beings, including humans, are not fixed and immutable. They evolved from a remote group of common primeval organisms in a process that started about 3.8 billion years ago. Nature as a story and an evolution. The relativization process has been emphasized by genetics. Every individual, whatever the species to which it belongs, is unique. So all individuals are pervaded by the same matter and the same processes. According to the geneticist Edoardo Boncinelli, many discoveries have brought to light the incredible unity of living beings. The fundamental processes and mechanisms that control them are essentially the same in all species. To make a sturgeon, a frog, a mouse, or a man, the programmed and coordinating action of a number of developmental genes is required, which the animals of all these species have in common, and which are also in the genetic heritage of insects and shellfish. But there is an even more general relativization level that can make possibly convert the two. Some time ago, I read an article by James Geach entitled The Lost Galaxies. The author is an astronomer who studies the evolution of galaxies, and in his articles he wonders about a lack of matter, of ordinary matter, not of dark matter, ordinary matter, in the total mass of matter of the known galaxies. The common idea of galaxies is of separate islands suspended in a dark, empty space with no interconnections, no matter exchange, like in Immanuel Kant's idea. But this model is incorrect. Galaxies are not closed systems and the space among them is not void. In fact, the lost matter resides in the intergalactic space and matter is continuously exchanged among galaxies, dynamically moving from one galaxy to another in a cycle that has been operational since the Big Bang. Computer simulations suggest that half of the matter currently present in galaxies of the local universe has crossed the intergalactic medium from one to many times. At the end of the article, there is this sentence. The baryons that make up your body have participated in this cycle for nearly 14 billion years. The matter within your fingernails could have formed in stars in other galaxies and then spent billions of years exiled intergalactic space before coming to rest in our solar system. A baryon is a composite subatomic particle made up of three quarks. Almost all usual matter is baryonic matter, which includes atoms of any sort. To make this sentence simpler, the term baryons can be replaced by ordinary matter. This article makes scientifically and poetically explicit what should be trivial. Obviously, all the atoms that make up the universe, answer for also Earth, living beings, artifacts, machines, and humans must have a common origin. But recalling the evidence that we are made of the same basic matter of stars, which is shared by all our ordinary universe, can sound profoundly inspiring. I want to conclude my presentation trying to summarize what I have said. Thanks to symbolic ability and symbolic acquisition, the human species has made almost ineffective natural evolution, moving away its pressure. While evolution has no finality and it is based on momentary success on the present, human species is overwhelmed by projects and goals. It compulsively imagines itself in the future, trying to address it and making it favorable, escaping the finitude of the present and disseminating memory of itself also through arts. The symbolic hypertrophy gave birth to a huge number of cultural variables like memberships, religions, beliefs, languages, perspectives, values, visions of the world, generating pseudo-species that pursue different and often violently conflicting purposes. Cultural evolution has made human species an abnormal member of planet Earth, the last remaining branch of genus Homo, the conqueror of any environment, and today's exploiter of a unique, immense ecological niche whose resources he is intensively dissipating. But it will not last forever. According to some scholars, the price of symbolic hypertrophy, the price of language, will be the end of human species. Its cultural magnificence will be the cause of its extinction. In particular, there is a very interesting study about a philosopher and a psychobiologist in this field that are very quoted. In the turn of geological times, its biology and a large part of its devices and artifacts will be quickly reabsorbed into the biology of the planet. Perhaps, to the human shore parable, will survive a part of its culture, the life forms that humanity creates from itself, its true legacy, its genius. Thank you for your patience.